The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
I hope you put your seatbelts on this morning, because this I'm not doing this to be difficult, but this will be difficult to absorb, because this is the sum total of life-changing revelation that God had given over a period of years, and it's applicable to absolutely everybody. It can be generically applied to any individual life. However, it's already worked in my life, past tense. It's presently working, and it shall yet come to fruition. So I'm not talking about how many people have had revelation where people says this is what we believe will happen. I'm talking about what God gave as a heavenly vision and has happened and will continue to happen. It is happening, and it shall continue to happen. Actually, that's good theology. Do you know that? Jesus was, he is, and he is yet to come. The kingdom of God was, the kingdom of God is, and the kingdom of God is yet to come in fuller dimension. And so just to make it a little bit easier on you, I did pass out some sheets. However, I'm going to do a review before we start. That's why we're starting early. I'm going to do a review of some, a couple of weeks ago, I've shared this already, but I'm going to give you the fast version of things that were shared in Full Gospel Businessmen and television and radio years ago. But I wanted to reiterate the faithfulness of God and to inspire and to ignite you to fulfill the vision that God's placed within your heart. And if you don't have one, I will give you one. I will give you a generic vision that is applicable to everyone. All right? So, late 1970s, I was smoking dope, sitting in front of the television, making fun of a TV evangelist, until that TV evangelist pointed his finger, and it was at me. And I was devastated. I got instantly saved, prayed the prayer with him over the television, took my dope over to the garbage disposal and was pouring it out and going, what? Here, you hear two voices, you know that? One is, dump it, but the other voice is going, you could have sold that. You go, what are you doing? Okay. And for 6 months, I just knew I had no great revelation, no big inspiration, other than this was the way we were meant to live for 6 months. And I did the best I could in that six-month period to just let God clean me up through forgiveness. At first, I thought it was impossible because I had dirty thoughts every other second, and I'm figuring, I got to go to work. How can I constantly keep my heart right when I'm so bad and I need so much work and I have to go to work? How am I going to do the two at the same time? And God basically, even though I was like a yo-yo, I was the original bipolar Christian. I had high highs and low lows, but they were all in the flesh. It wasn't spirit. It was just me manifesting and then repenting, manifesting and then repenting. So there was nothing spiritual about it. It was pretty carnal. But I did know that all of a sudden there was a real devil. That was the only thing that I could say apart from Christ and his reality in my life. The only thing I realized is there really is evil, and that there was something out there to get me, that there actually was evil. I knew there's people that believed in God and didn't believe in a devil. And I saw the evil manifest the minute I pursued Jesus. The minute I pursued him, there was other things that unleashed. Okay. So I'm a young believer for 6 months. My dad brought a book home, and it was about a gambler who had been on the 700 Club and got saved and quit gambling and wrote a book. But apart from that, I had only read the Bible. That was the only Christian book I read. And I heard about this church some 25 miles away from where I lived, where Catholics and Protestants were coming together. Okay. Now, I went to that church, and I was kind of amazed that there was nuns and priests and charismatic-type people all in the same room, which I had been raised Catholic, so I didn't really know what to do with that. But I could feel the presence of God, and they, at that time, were having huge altar calls. People were getting saved. This is in the 70s. People were getting saved at these meetings constantly. And the pastor was a little bald-headed guy, kind of looked like Elmer Fudd. I'm not making fun of him. He's with Jesus now. But he'd play a grand piano, and when the altar calls would come, he just would sit at that grand piano and just play lightly on the keyboard. And I was invited to go to this church after I'd been saved about 6 months. And this is my first supernatural. I was standing by, and it was a pew because they were old. It was an old evangelical church. He was a Princeton professor who taught professors. He was a professor's professor. And someone has since heard this message a few weeks ago, looked him up, and they found some of his old teachings online. He was a brilliant, brilliant man, a Princeton graduate, Princeton professor, and he's done a lot of love messages, and you can actually go online and find those. His name is Len Evans, the Love Commandment, and all of his teachings were on that. But I went to this church 20-some miles away, and I'm standing, and I had my first supernatural experience. They had an altar call for salvation, and I knew that I was already saved, but my body was going forward, and I was trying to hang on to the pew, and I started getting scared because I never felt, 6 months, I never felt nothing in my Christianity except my yo-yo experiences. And I felt my body going up, so finally I just said, you know, what's it going to hurt? Then they says, and also for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So I'm going, well, that's something. I already know I'm saved, so I'll go up. I had no idea what they were talking about. I went up. This guy gave me this big, long thing, and I don't remember a single word that he said. All I know is I opened my heart and went, okay, all right. So I go home. I didn't feel anything specifically. But by the way, on my way out of that church, I met a young man who, when I was unsaved, I managed a shoe store, and this man would come in and tell me about Jesus, and I would physically pick him up, this is embarrassing, and throw him out and told him never to come back. And he saw me in church. He goes, hi, Dennis. I knew I would see you here someday. So anyway, so I went home, and at least a week, almost a week after that service, I'm going, I feel like I am wimpy as far as telling anybody I've been that I accepted Jesus 6 months ago. Like, I talk about other Christians, but I don't talk about me. And it was wimpy. And I started getting convicted that I was wimpy. Well, I'm going to go tell my mom and dad. And so I got the courage up, and I went, and I drove over to my mom and dad's house, flung open the door, and I was going to tell them that Jesus is Lord of my life. And I walked in, and nobody was home. All right. So in the meantime, I had gotten one Bible into the house, and it was my sister kept it. So I'm there, nobody's home, and I'm all full of boldness, and I'm going, oh. So I walked upstairs, went in my sister's bedroom where the only Bible in the house was, because my parents didn't have a Bible. I walked in there and opened up the Bible, and I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden, I'm glancing down, nothing's making sense, and I'm going, I don't know what's going on, but all of a sudden, I started talking to God in street language that, you know what, God, these last 6 months is the way everybody's supposed to live. And if my legs were cut off, I would still live for you. Street talk. I was telling God I was really tough about this thing. God, if my legs were cut off, I would still live for you and serve you all the days of my life. And I don't want that to happen, God, but I'm just telling you, I'm trying to make a point here, God, that I'm really serious about this. And the minute I did that, the power of God hit me, and I'd never felt presence prior to that to any large degree. The power of God hit me. I flooded. In my mind's eye, I saw Jesus flooding me from head to toe. I lifted my hands, and I think I must have saw it at that church, but I lifted my hands, never done that before, and I lifted my hands, and I saw the Holy Spirit empowering me through Jesus Christ himself, worshiping the Father in heaven. And it was like an instant understanding of Trinity in a way I had never known before, especially not as a young Catholic. And I opened it up, and the joy of the Lord was so strong. I began to speak in other tongues. I didn't know what that was. And the joy of the Lord was so strong that my first thought was someday in heaven we have to have a different body because this body's about ready to blow up. I can't take it anymore. But I didn't want to say I can't take it. And then I thought I'm losing my mind, but if I'm losing my mind, I want to stay this way, which is an unusual concept. But if that wasn't enough, in the midst of that joy, and that joy, by the way, never subsided for another 6 months. It was a cloud relationship that I looked around at other Christians and I couldn't even communicate because I just didn't see it everywhere and I didn't know what to do with that. You don't just talk to everybody that had the same kind of experience, so you didn't know what to do. But I noticed that there were people, even people that went to Christian functions, they were just looking for a job. They're going to Christian businessmen, but they're trying to get a job. They didn't care about Jesus. And it was real obvious, all right? But anyway, all I know is I had this supernatural experience, and then in the midst of it, up there in the house, my mom's house, all by myself, all of a sudden, with my eyes wide open, not my mind's eye like Father, Son, Holy Spirit, with my eyes wide open, letters of living light flashed in the air. And I read it with my entire being. That's the only way I'd explain it. And I could see it today as if it was today. And it said, Grand Book and Bible. And the letters were alive. And that was the name of a Christian bookstore that wasn't far away. It was about a mile away. Never went inside of it, but I knew where it was at. Grand Book and Bible. And I'm stunned. I went to Catholic school in kindergarten, first grade, second grade. That was the extent of my religious training. And I did not understand why is this happening to me because I felt like I was garbage and that this doesn't happen. This happens to popes and cardinals and bishops, you know, people with collars and robes and stuff. So I have this open vision and my entire body was reading this Grand Book and Bible. And so I didn't know what to do. The only Bible in the house was right there. And I opened it, and the page went blank except for one word, obey. And so when you don't know what to do and you just had a vision, Grand Book and Bible, obey, I got in the car, and I'm going to Grand Book and Bible. And I'm going, and I'm in this, like, stunned place because I don't have any more instruction. If it wasn't for obey, I'd have probably just stood there frozen all that time. Grand Book and Bible. And so obey. And so I'm in the car. And, of course, you hear the devil's voice at the same time. Do you know that? No matter what supernatural happens, you still hear. And he's going, you're crazy. You tell anybody this happened, and they're going to lock you up. And that was rational. You know, I believe that was a possibility, but I'm going, I don't care if I'm losing my mind. I've never felt this good in my life. I want to stay this way. So I drive, I go into the Grand Book and Bible. And now my dad wasn't a Christian, but somebody handed him the book from this guy, the only Christian book, this former gambler who had been on. And so my instructions ended, so I go in this Bible store, and I'm looking at books, but I'm not reading, because I'm in like in this daze, like, oh my God, what am I doing? Well, at least I obeyed, and so I'm reading books, but I'm not reading books, and all of a sudden, this lady grabs me by the shoulder that worked there, and she says, young man, there is the perfect person for you to talk to right now, and she took me over, and here was that guy doing a book signing to the only Christian book I ever read, and I went, oh, he might understand. And so I walked up to him, and I know to this day he never really understood anything I said because I was talking at supersonic speed. I went to my mother's house, and I went in the bedroom, and the light was shining. And I said, Grand Book of Bible. And then I go, so yeah, my body was going like this, and I got the joy, and I was a little happy. And he didn't know what to do with me. As a lot of Christians, you don't know what to do when someone's like that. And so he just laid hands on me. He said, I think you need to go to the Christian businessman's lunch next week. I'm afraid it was in the middle of the week, a Wednesday or Tuesday or something. Go to this Christian businessman's lunch. And I went, okay. So now I figured the only reason I went there was to go to this Christian businessman's lunch. But now I'm struggling with the power of God unlike anything I'd ever read about or heard about. And I just didn't know what to do with all of this. And day after day, you start thinking and hashing out, and that's where the danger comes in. You're figuring it out, and I kept figuring it out, and I was getting more and more distressed. Then I'm thinking, I'm going to go tell my parents something. And I went, and bold as a lion now, I walk in, fling open the door, and they're not home. So I'm going, oh, man, this is the same scenario. And there's a magazine rack, and one of the subscriptions was the Psychology Today. And on the cover was about UFO children going into to intelligent, educated people going in the Arizona desert to get on a spaceship to go to the Father's Kingdom. And inside, I wanted to, like, throw up. It was nauseating. And I'm going, God, how could people be so deceived? How could educated people be so deceived? And so I just started wandering around. It felt terrible. And I wander around. Guess what? I went back up to my sister's bedroom where the only Bible was. And I opened the Bible, just plain old, flipped it open. And it happened again. A verse of scripture, Hosea 3:5, literally, not imagination, came off into the air. And it answered my grief about how could intelligent people be so crazy. And the verse that came off was Hosea 3:5, and this was a Living Bible translation. Hosea 3:5 said, afterward, they will return to the Lord their God and to the Messiah their King, and they will come trembling and submissive to the Lord and his goodness in the latter days, in the end times, his goodness. So they would come trembling and submissive to the Lord, but they would be coming to his goodness. It's repentance, but they're coming to his goodness. It's repentance, and afterward, after what? After they've exhausted all of their foolishness, and that's the way my life was. I tried to find happiness in everything, and nothing worked. I had 5 jobs in 5 months, because as soon as I could do the job, it wasn't making me happy. That's how I got saved. And so I was kind of one of those afterwards. So I understood then, it gave me great hope for the move of God to change people's lives, because after they're done and they've exhausted their own efforts, they shall return to the Lord their God and to the Messiah. But that scripture was off the page and in the air. And I'm going, oh my goodness, I can't handle all this stuff. None of these Christians that I've run into so far talk like this, act like this, or had this kind of stuff happen. And I've got to talk to somebody with authority. Now, with my Catholic background, authority meant you had a collar. And I started to struggle with, well, that guy in the bookstore, he told me to go to that Christian businessman's lunch, and he wrote a Christian book, and he was on television, but he didn't have a collar. He might not have authority. He might not be who I should be talking to, and I don't know what to do. I've got to talk to somebody with authority. I've had too much of this stuff, and nobody's explaining any of this stuff to me. I don't understand what's happening. I know I don't want to change, because the joy is so strong that I've never known anything like this in my life. This is above and beyond anything I'd ever even heard about. And so I'm going to just drive down the street, and there's a main street where I used to live where there's churches on both sides, every denomination imaginable. And I'm just driving, tears are just pouring down my face, going, I got to talk to somebody. Somebody's got to tell me I'm not, somebody's got to explain this. There's got to be somebody spiritual enough. And all of a sudden, the car turned itself. Have you ever had a flat tire where the wheel jerked like that? Well, I didn't have a flat tire, but the wheel jerked like that. And I turned in, and it was a Presbyterian church after passing at least a dozen churches. If you go on that street, there's churches everywhere, all different denominations, Catholic, Protestant, what have you. I turned in there, and my heart started pounding, going, oh, no, this stuff is still happening. Here, I'm looking for someone to explain this stuff that's already happened, and it's still happening. This is weeks of this. And so I pull in, and I go into the office of the church, and I already have religion now. I don't know what to do, because that's where it ended. The car turned there. I knew I was supposed to go in there, and I don't know what to do or who to ask for or what. So I walked over. They had some brochures on the wall, and I said, what must I do to be born again? Well, I said, I recognize that part. What must I do to be? And so I'm browsing, because I learned this in the Christian bookstore, right? Just be dumb and don't know what you're doing. And I'm just looking. And the secretary came, who later became a member of my church many years later, but the secretary came and said, young man, you must have questions. I've got the perfect person for you to talk to. She grabs me by the arm, just like in the bookstore, takes me downstairs, and here these the two ministers are down there praying. And one of them had a collar, because he was Presbyterian. One of them had a collar. So I went, I can't hold this in no more. This guy was on television. He said, I asked Jesus to come into my heart, and I went to my mother's house, and nobody was home, and ended up this thing, and this light, and this grand book and Bible, and I'm going, I don't think they understood what I was saying here, because I was so busy crying. Who knows what I actually got out of me? And the guy without the collar that was sitting down there said, do you not know who I am? No. He says, I'm that pastor from that church 20-some miles away. I came in here to visit my friend here at this church. And he said, but let me tell you something. Their altar calls would have at least 80 to 100 people come forward for salvation and for Holy Spirit baptism. This was charismatic renewal days. This is the way a church service was. And he said, I have a habit. He says that when people come forward, I single one person out of the multitudes at the altar. I single out one person, and then that one person, I pray for just that one person. And he says, young man, you were that person that I singled out when you came forward to my altar a few weeks ago. And he says, and not only that, but God gave me a word that while I was focusing in on you, God says, you're going to see this young man again. And he says, and by the way, you know that man you're talking about at that Christian luncheon? He says, you need to go to that. He said, I'm the guest speaker. And he gave me a verse of scripture that has lasted and unfolded to this day. Many times we say it in the beginning of a service out of habit, but it's more than that for me. He says, in the supernatural realm, he said, God began a good work in you, and he will continue it until the day of Jesus. And it's been like that for me. My life is, that's like the beginning, but it's been like that all the way till now. And I want to get into some of the other stuff. That's kind of a review. But he who began a good work is continuing. He was, he is yet to come. And I believe I want to bring it up to date. And the title of the message is The Vision of the Dome. The Vision of the Dome. By the way, just to jump ahead, the only time I was ever in a trance was I got the vision of a dome. And it was less than 20 minutes, but I'll never forget it as long as I live, and it's never happened again since then. But I got a download standing. You've got, we passed out the pages of that little dome-like structure. That if anybody doesn't have one, slip up your hand. Someone will give it to you because it's easier to follow it. We have a few here. Dawn, can you see them? All right. And I'm going to ask Cliff to even put it on the overhead. This is what we want you to have for people that are watching by Ustream. We always have more people watching by Ustream. Matter of fact, it was a person from Germany watching Ustream that let us know that they looked up some of Len Evans, my earliest mentor, some of his sermons. He's been with Jesus now, but he would do the ontology of the love commandment, and he would just break it down with all heady stuff, but it was the love message of Jesus, bottom line. And it's brilliant stuff, and you can go online and find it under his name. But this emerged and developed over my entire life, and it still is. It's generic. It looks kind of silly, but guess what? If God put me in a trance, and what he did was, in this so-called trance, I was in a friend's house who had a stained glass window. Have you ever seen a stained glass window where there was a arching piece of stained glass? Then there was three panels of stained glass. And then there was because it was a window, it had your little foundations, right? They had those little strips of wood in layers. And God basically just burned it in my heart. Four foundational layers, three pillars, and a dome. So to get ahead of my story, not that it was necessary, but this was a heavenly download. When God wouldn't let me go to Bible school, he said, I'm going to take you to the school of the Spirit. And he says, I'm going to teach you how to develop this temple. So for me, that's a mini temple, but it's generic enough, it'll work for anybody. We call this the vision of the house now, but I think people need to understand that it started as this temple and only this temple. And until it worked in this temple, it was many years later that I built a church, and actually church is people, not a building, but just for the sake of the object lesson, to keep the vision before the people, we built a dome sanctuary. And you can see pictures of it in the bookstore if you want to look. We built a dome sanctuary as an object lesson. But when I first had this download, I planted my first church in a vacuum cleaner building, and we went and purchased a little, what do you call that? The wood. Yeah, it was a geodesic dome model made in wood. It was that real light wood?
Balsa
wood. Okay. It was a balsa wood model of a dome building, and I didn't really care if I ever had a dome church or not, because what God downloaded was, I'm giving you the principles that I'm not letting you go to Bible school. I'm taking you to the school of the Spirit, and this is the temple. Don't worry about other people's temples, and don't worry about building a church, even though your calling is to plant churches from scratch. Nonetheless, what you've got to live it before you replicate it. All right? And so that's what I wanted to share today, because the other message that I shared earlier, the introduction, I already did a few weeks ago, but all of these teachings have been lost because of the transition from cassette to CD and DVD. So you're going to get it up hand. Here's the vision of the dome, the way God gave it to me in this download. First of all the scriptural corroboration is generic. First of all, without a redemptive vision, the people perish. You've heard it said, without a prophetic revelation, the people perish. But without a redemptive vision, you perish. In other words, the people cast off restraint and people do what they want to do. Just like in the book of Judges, everyone does what's right in their own eyes. Everybody concocts a vision out of their own plans and schemes and ideas. But I'll tell you what, I didn't pick this. God put me in looking at that friend of mine's stained glass window, and for 20 minutes I was somewhere else. And God downloaded that this was going to be the structure on how for Dennis to build and equip this temple. And here's the way he did it. He showed me that scripturally, without a redemptive revelation, I'm not going to ask you to build something by man's expertise or Madison Avenue techniques. I'm going to give you a heavenly vision. You build according to this. And it takes childlike faith to do something like this, because this would sound silly to most people. But basically, God says there's only two aspects of the vision in a practical way that I've made for you, and this applies to you too, whether you ever do anything with it or not, is the redemptive revelation that is generic. Is first of all, I was just like the Apostle Paul says in Galatians 1:15-16. If you have forms, it's right there on the top. It pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, and he called me by his grace to reveal his son in me. That should be everybody's primary vision, to reveal his son in you. God chose you as a believer to reveal his son in you. That's an internal vision, and that's where God starts. It's not about what you do for him. It's about whether or not you're revealing his son in you. Then secondarily, because I had so many dramatic visions and revelations, I was not disobedient to that heavenly vision, and to this day, I still live this. I still preach this. And everything I learned is a magnification of these patterns and principles. And guess what? It's worked. I know there's a lot of people that tell you this is what God's going to do in the future, but they haven't done it yet. That's they're speaking potential. I'm speaking of what was, what is currently working, and what shall work, because I've already got the track record. And if God's in it, I'm not changing my course because someone's got a good idea. I've got a God idea, and this download is what I'll have to go to. From the cradle to the grave, this is what I'm responsible for teaching and preaching. Now, I'm not disobedient to that heavenly vision, and I won't be. And God said on the bottom, two verses of scripture, one in the Old Testament, one in the New. God said, if you build according to this pattern in your life, then what you're going to see, Dennis, is that out of your belly is going to flow rivers of living water. And in the Old Testament, it was Ezekiel's temple. And the waters flowed from the base of the temple. And wherever those waters flowed, produced life. Do you want to produce life or not? Out of your innermost being, do you want it to flow or not? That's basically the question. Okay, so everything that God developed started very much with, I don't know how to start a church. I haven't taken church growth courses. I'm going to do this in me first. So here's how it started in me. There is no other foundation other than the foundation of Jesus Christ. You agree? Then my bottom was intimacy with God, and that you can never skip intimacy. You preach it until they get tired of hearing it, but so what? Because many in that day will say, did I not cast out devils? Did I not prophesy in your name? And he says, I knew you not. Because intimacy was the one thing. You got into works and you got into religious function, but you didn't know me intimately. Therefore, everything that we birthed, all of our written material is basically coming from that one bottom foundation. There's no other foundation other than the reality of Jesus. Your value system is not just doctrine. Your value system is a person, and intimacy with that person is the only foundation. But when God showed me this dome, he also showed me that he is both the foundation and the capstone. And that dome in Zechariah says they brought the capstone, the finishing touches, with shouts of grace to it. And he showed me that basically the foundations were where I needed to start. The pillars were the priority, and the dome was the kind of atmosphere he wanted coming from me. So I didn't build a dome church to build a round ceiling, which we had. It was that it was to be indicative of the atmosphere that you create of love, acceptance, and forgiveness. If you create any other atmosphere of any model other than a love model, is not a true vision from God. If it doesn't have the love of God in it, it's been perverted or distorted. So, God basically started on the person, intimacy. And it was the ability to know him by the Spirit and by his divine nature and be a partaker of that divine nature. And we've taught on this in times past. The second building block was patterns and principles. And I really believe that from an early time, God wanted me to learn the wisdom of application. Don't just know the word, know how I operate. And the best way to study that was the Beatitudes and Proverbs. And so basically, I was self-taught, but I basically lost myself in God and said, I want to know how to do. I want to know through intimacy how to be a partaker of those divine natures, but I want to know what kind of, and basically what he emphasized was attitude. Did you know that the Beatitudes are attitudes that were to be? Be like this, all right? And literally look at the Beatitudes and you find out that if the heart matches the Beatitudes that God builds, and this is all about building a life, for me first, all that has to do with building has to do with a proper attitude, but God builds according to a pattern based on principles. Do you believe that? God builds according to patterns. Well, I had a heavenly pattern. And as long as it was corroborated scripturally, that was my application, that he's going to build according to a pattern based on a principle. And I saw that he used Proverbs and the Beatitudes for the most time, and parables. Parables, the Beatitudes, and I began to see the way he works. Therefore, you can question, even when you get a word, is that the way God works? Because he always works to the goal of wanting oneness. His way is always love, and his word is always truth. All right? So I began to look at the patterns and principles. Then I looked at the next foundation, and it was in my Bible in Hebrews 6. It says, these are the foundational teachings of Christ. Now, if they're foundational, I would think that belongs in your foundation. Repentance from dead works, faith toward God, baptisms, laying on of hands, resurrections from the dead, all right, judgments, if that's foundational, then I better study them and know them. I think every believer should know Hebrews 6. That's a nice basics course, really. If these are the elementary principles, then you're going to build on these things. You need to understand these. And I'll tell you what, I'm not going to get into, I've taught on those. I had my church memorized Hebrews 6 and had a working knowledge of how to apply Hebrews 6. We're not going there today. But for me, repentance from dead works was truly applied to my life in relationship with Jesus. It was basically a spiritual walk. Not dead works, not a bunch of religion. But it was repentance from dead works means no dead works, only the living works or a walk in the Spirit. Anyway, we're going to move on though. The fourth building block, and I love it because you know where it's at? It's on the bottom. It is built upon the foundation, the foundation, the foundation. No, your CD's not skipping. The foundation of apostles and prophets. Built upon the foundation. That means it's not a hierarchy of lordship of bosses, but it's rather servant leaders that are supposed to be doing something in their serving, and they're on the bottom. I'm not minimizing their importance. I'm sitting there saying servant leadership that God taught me from an early time that this model was that I knew 2 Timothy 1:11 is what God called me to, and I didn't apologize, and I was in churches that I used to get them all upset. They took me out to steak dinner even because I got them so upset in their theology. But I said, I don't know, but God told me 2 Timothy 1:11, whereunto I have appointed you a preacher, an apostle, a teacher of the Gentiles. Well, as soon as you said apostle, you mean, till. And I'm going, I really don't care. That was the verse God gave me, and that's all I care about. I'll let him apply it, right? I'm not hung up on titles, but neither should you have such a negative reaction toward them. Because they're definitive. They're describing an action. You should learn about it. Oh, that Dennis is such a sweet boy. I had all these leaders in this Pentecostal church take me out to the Brown Derby and buy me steak to let me down gently. But anyway, I probably kept them awake at nights. That leadership foundation of apostles and prophets, Messiah himself gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. Equipping means like basically hearts that are knit together. Equipping meaning setting in place like bones are set. He's setting the bones together. They're being set. They're being positioned. Fivefold ministers are not to just be popes and bosses. They are to be those who are equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry and teaching them how to connect one with another, which in reality, we're going to get to that. It's still the weakest thing that I see in the body of Christ. And if that will keep us as a small congregation, it's the will of God. I want to stay that way. I want on fire people who have moved beyond, listen to what I'm saying, moved beyond, I call it, false independence. It's a legitimate stage of growth, but most people quit there. And they become part of this overall body of Christ, and it's just me and Jesus. That in reality, as far as spiritual development, that is not mature. Mature, it is true, if you went from sickly dependent to independent and standing on your own 2 feet, that is major progress. To quit there is deception. It is major progress to go from sickly dependent in the natural to independent. You think what? I've arrived. But John spoke to three groups. I speak to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven. I speak to you, young men, because the word of God abides in you strong. You've overcome the wicked one. What would happen when you start talking to young men and young women like that? The word of God abides in you strong. You've overcome the wicked one. You stop there thinking you've arrived. And you haven't arrived until you're a mature mother and father in Christ. And a mature mother and father has to get beyond that young man, rugged, renegade, independent person. That is not maturity. I've seen people hide behind the title saying, well, you don't understand. I don't submit to anybody because you don't understand. I'm part of the overall body of Christ. Until they have a need, then they go to the tangible body of Christ and ask for help. But otherwise, they're independent and they're free. It's like the myth of the wild and the free horses running the range. And they're also sickly and dying because what they really need is cared for, corralled in many cases, and taken care of. Anyway, all right, so enough of that. So what I saw was that last foundation, God was teaching me about fivefold ministers, and he was teaching me that their job was to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry, not be the expert. That still hasn't changed in the church. Not to be the expert, but to be the coach. Not to be the one who does it all, watch me, but to teach others to do the same thing. This vision I'm giving you, if you applied this to your life, you'd be changed. It's generic enough. Christ being formed in you and then being obedient to do anything he's told you to do. As long as you know that it's not a goal that you made. This keeps it in the character realm. So this last one, I saw that he is knitting hearts together, setting the bones for the work of the ministry. You know what this means? Becoming interdependent. That people run from that. If I preached on that 4 weeks in a row, we could clear out a few. Interdependence is terrorizing because people hear that as an affront to my individuality. And I'm saying, no, no. It's an affront to your destiny because destiny will always include other people. And until you can relate properly in a healthy way, you're probably poking in the eye the people that God placed in your life to fulfill your destiny because of your unresolved conflicts and your immaturity in relating to people. And the devil's not beating you up. Your carnality is beating you up. Quit blaming the devil for stuff. I always wonder why these people are under spiritual warfare all the time when I'm saying I can see the loose ends in your life. You're not having spiritual warfare. Your carnality's slapping you around. All right? Deal with your own carnality and you're going to find out. Because what am I, chopped liver? I said, I've accomplished a lot of things that God told us to do, past tense. And every one of those things was in obedience to God. But I didn't live in the kind of spiritual warfare that people are talking about. So what's that mean? Somehow, I accomplished God-given, ordained instructions. Now, I've had spiritual warfare. I know what that's like. But I'm saying most people, it's unnecessary trials and tribulations. Big difference between spiritual warfare and unnecessary trials and tribulations. So I saw that the purpose of fivefold ministry on the bottom then was to build a holy temple of people. In other words, love is the only cord that puts people together, otherwise you've got bondage. But there is a bond in Scripture that we've avoided, and it's the bond of peace. It's the bonds of love and peace. And it's supernatural bondings, and you have to be able to cooperate with the Holy Spirit to find that out. And it's living stones being set in place. This is what fivefold ministers are supposed to be doing. And I'll tell you what, fivefold ministers do that, you're gonna weed out the ranks quickly. Because we live in an age of rugged individualism. And we call that maturity and freedom. And in reality, you're missing out on your destiny because you've never become part of something bigger than yourself. And that's what happens. So I saw that God was basically saying that the fivefold ministers are to bring us like living stones, set us in place until we come to the unity of the knowledge of the Son of God. People are afraid of that kind of unity. We've got it in our leadership here. We've got roughly 50 people, I would say, in this congregation total. 50. But we've got 8 pastors that are quality. And that's just our core. I think we got some interns that are coming up and are going to amount to something. The world's going to hear from them. That's out of a little place like this. So I'll tell you what. It might be a hard message, it might be demanding message, but you know what? You can go anywhere and get, I'm okay, you're okay, and get a crowd. I don't want a crowd of stones, a heap of stones like Ai. I want a Bethel. I want a house of God, a habitation of God in the Spirit, and that's what we're building here, to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a mature man. That mature man is corporate. You can't... God had no intention of raising up. See, when he says, here's what I want to do. I want to equip an army. Is that corporate? I want to prepare a bride. Is that corporate? And I want to grow a family. Is that corporate? Then where's this rugged, I got to be free, I got to do my thing, I got to be everywhere, I got to do everything, and somehow by osmosis, I'm going to get all the right stuff. No, that's more of a, almost like a, no offense, teenagers, but that's almost a teenage mentality. You get to a place where finally you are on your own, finally you are going to be given some responsibility, but that doesn't mean you've arrived, and it doesn't mean you know more than your parents yet. You don't have enough life experience under you. Though you have 10,000 instructors, you don't have many fathers. And that is true. All right. So I'm looking at this. And all of these things, now mind you, this is not later I applied this in a church setting, but not until this was my life. So before I was pastoring, I served. And I served leaders. And a prophet even came to me, a well-known one, came and basically said, Dennis, because you were faithful in another man's ministry, God has given you your own. And when I did come time, I served silently without anybody knowing that I was serving. And it was an 1,100-member church, so I served him. And when the time came, it was him, the bald-headed pastor, and a friend of mine. Messianic Jew. All three of them merged together and took me out to lunch and said, it's time for you to start your church, Dennis. I had the approval and the sending forth. I was commissioned by established people with reputation, not self-appointed. There's a difference. Matter of fact, when we got ordained, we were ordained by Bishop Hammond in Santa Rosa Beach, California. Florida. And what year was that? 2002. And he quit ordaining people, but he was told by regional managers and seasoned apostolic network leaders, you need to make an exception for these two people. And I'm not bragging on myself. I'm showing you how God does it when you don't promote yourself. That's my point. And people who had apostolic networks contacted them and said, Dennis is clearly called with an apostolic anointing. They ordained me as an apostle. You don't even hear of that kind of stuff. And I'm not hung up on the titles because it's more important of whether you do it or not than what your title is. I've been in churches where everybody had a title and nobody did nothing. So I'm not impressed with the title, but I am impressed with the fact that validation, that it's God that lifts up one and puts down another. And you want your validation from God. I was ordained in 1980 based on proven ministry because I had a parachurch ministry that was bigger than most churches. So I didn't get to their Bible school. I didn't get the traditional way. But I did it the way that was really going to be written on the tablet of your heart, and it builds a God confidence because man didn't do it. Man didn't do it. And if man didn't do it, then he can't hire me and fire me because I was God appointed. I didn't confer with flesh and blood, but God gave this to me. All right? So now I see the wisdom why God wouldn't let me go to school, even though I was really upset because I had to do it all by myself. Now, God was basically saying until we come to the unity or one accord, the knowledge of the intimacy, abiding in the Son of God, unto a mature man unto the stature of the fullness of Christ. Not surprising, our ministry's name, Full Stature Ministries. As a matter of fact, God gave me so much vision that even later on, and I'm jumping ahead now, to after I was a pastor, a young pastor, youngest of a group of pastors, they were setting up a network of churches, an apostolic network. I had so much vision that they would tease me. I was the baby pastor, but I had vision blowing up out of me. I've had vision from the very beginning, and it always continued to build, but I didn't get it from man. I got it from God. And it worked. I already have a track record. It's already worked. So this is not future tense, doesn't work. All right? And they even got to the point where they were getting paranoid in a joking kind of way. I had 7 seasoned pastors, all had huge ministries. They were setting up a network, and they're saying, we got to have a logo for this new network. And somebody drew a circle on the board. They were going to put an arrow through it or something. They drew a circle, and they go, everybody stood up. They went, no, 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 that's Dennis. That's an aerial view of his dome. We can't use that. Dennis is imposing his vision on us. And then they all laugh because that's what I did. If you don't have a vision, I'll give you one. I've got more than I know what to do with. And guess what? It works for everybody. As a matter of fact, if you wanted to start a church, this would be a good way to start a church, providing you're actually living it first, because I had to do this temple. Out of this temple had to flow rivers of living water. Now, let me get back. We're only on the foundation, which isn't the foundation the most important thing? And that cross way up there at the top, that capstone, he is both the foundation. He's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, isn't he? All right. See those three pillars? Pillar number one. God said, pillar number one is worship in the Word. If you're doing all of those foundational things, starting mainly with intimacy with God, then worship in the Word for you, Dennis, in this temple, before you go teaching it to anybody else's group, has to be spirit and truth. He never let me just get off on clever truths. Jennifer has her doctorate in theology, and she says there were people she studied that she doubted they were even saved. Is that possible? They certainly didn't understand the Holy Spirit. And with this model, God said basically, Dennis, from that download, I am demanding that you don't just learn doctrine, that you learn that reality, that it has to be reality. That middle pillar is worship in the Word to me. It'd be worship in the Word would be Christianese. But you know what it was for me? Reality. I'm going to worship him in spirit and truth, not spirit or truth. Because there's people that have a lot of truth, with no spirit. There's people got a lot of spirit and they're all over the place. Spirit and truth means the reality of the person of Jesus Christ being made manifested. Can I have something? What's priority one in simple language? Worship in the Word. You can say it that simple, but if you make it reality, it'll put a demand on your spirit for reality. You need to know him. Priority number two. Priority number two was that what God said is from the place of reality, you can go to true discipleship. That's what you would call it in Christianese, discipleship. But he said, for me, it was transformation. You can disciple people and their lives aren't changed. That's not discipleship. Discipleship is a changed life. So that middle pillar, priority number one, Dennis, is worship in the Word or reality. Priority number two is now you can move to priority number two, because from that reality you want to change life. And check yourself to see if you're changing. Or are you just growing in knowledge and you look the same to everybody else around? It put a demand on this temple to see if there was bearing fruit or not. You shall know them by their fruit, not just by their lip service or by how much Bible they know, but did it change? Did it work? You know, that's the thing that I'm the most excited about our books. I've seen people from around the world that took our books and found out that it works. There's some that'll just read it, and it'll go in their head, and they'll go, that's interesting. And then there's others that will apply it and make it a reality and see changed lives. So priority number two, you would call it discipleship. I call it transformation. I called priority one reality, spirit, and truth. For this reason, the Son of God was manifested, not just to destroy the works of the devil, but to, it says in the scriptures that he came to reveal truth for this purpose. I came to reveal truth. I am the truth. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And so God says, basically, truth for me had to be reality. It had to be Jesus. If it's not Jesus, you just got information. If that information changes to two, it will be transformation. If that changes from transformation, then you've got priority three. Now you're a candidate for priority three. And this created quite a dilemma, because priority three would be called in Christianese evangelism. But God said, I want application of the transformation. I want impartation I want it written on the tablet of people's hearts. I want substance that can be communicated. Evangelism, I see evangelism around the world based on what denomination is evangelizing. That's the product it produces. You reproduce according to your kind. God said, I don't want them to be reproduced. I don't want to start going to some country in Panama and see people looking like they're Americans or Europeans. You know, why not impact the culture with Jesus and let them bring that reality to their culture instead of bringing your culture and imposing it on them? Now, if three is truly a release of spiritual anointing, that's when God showed me that out of my belly would flow rivers of living water, and that you would be giving substance that whosoever would open their spirit, not just their minds, but their spirit could receive it, because it's real in you. If it's real in you, you can give it away. And wherever that healing water flows, it'll bring health and healing to people. But it's almost like I used to enjoy watching people in my first congregation, if they weren't sleeping, with their eyes closed, they were drinking in the substance of what I was saying more than the understanding of what I was saying. That is a big plus. Very few do that, but you know how to do that. You do it in worship. Why don't you do it in preaching? Why not draw on the substance of the preaching instead of just the information? In worship, you want to touch him, meet him, and express him. How about receiving? It should be, you should be pulling, I want to pull the substance and the reality so that whatever Dennis is preaching, that if it's substance in his life, it can be written on the tablet of my heart instead of just in my mind. Now, that's when God said basically that in the Old Testament, that wherever the river goes, it will live. And there will be a great multitude of fish, because wherever these water go, they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes. Jesus stood on that day of the feast and said, if anyone come unto me and drink, if he thirst, come unto me and drink, for out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. God wants you to be that temple. Then we get to the capstone, and there were four elements, and this came years later, and I jumped up. I was in my church office. I was pastoring by this time. I jumped up, and I started pacing. I got so excited, I couldn't contain myself. I couldn't sit still. God showed me that he wanted that atmosphere to be love, acceptance, forgiveness, and grace, and I was reading some stuff about the cross. I get chills even thinking about it. And God basically said, it was the application of the cross that basically produced love, acceptance, forgiveness, and grace. I don't think we have a chart for this. I'm going to let you write it down. Justification. How many have heard that word, biblical word? Justification. Justification is love. If you apply the principle of justification, God demonstrated his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. So it's just as if we hadn't sinned. Justification. That was a demonstration of the love of God. It had nothing to do with you. To the degree that that's revelatory in your life, that you've been justified by faith, to the degree you will know that you are loved, completely and unconditionally loved. Don't you think a lot of believers need to know that they're unconditionally and completely loved, even though they know it theoretically, all right? And to the degree you don't know that truth, you must perform to a certain standard to feel good about yourself. If you've got to perform in Christianity to feel good about yourself, there is missing the ingredient of justification or the finished work of the cross, that you are deeply and wonderfully made, and that you are loved by God, and that his love is sufficient. He doesn't need you to perform. That'll break that performance trap, and it'll bring you back to the love of God presses me on all sides, eliminating all other options. To love. All right? So I am loved. Justification produces, you see that cross on the top? God basically said, through the work of the cross, you get love, acceptance, forgiveness. There's four elements. Justification, if you're a note taker, write these down, because this is not on the notes. Justification, reconciliation. Propitiation. And regeneration. Justification, reconciliation, propitiation, and regeneration. I am loved, I am accepted, I am forgiven, I am what I am by the grace of God, and I like me. That's simple English for those four big words. If they're operating in your life through the work of the cross. If they're not operating in your life, there's still the carnality of your flesh that says, I must perform to feel good about myself. There's a weakness in justification. There's a love deficit. If you think you have to perform for God to feel good. The second one, I must have the approval of certain other people to feel good about myself. You know what? God took me through that whole season of prayer. That's a whole nother revelation we'll get into someday. The seven life-changing encounters that I had. But encounter number one was that, Dennis, I'm giving you my undivided attention. You're the apple of my eye. You're the center of my attention. There never was another you. There never will be another you. I am what I am. And I am accepted in the beloved. And that purged out all rejection. The one thing Dennis doesn't need is to be accepted by people when you have the acceptance of God. God's acceptance is written on the tablet of your heart. You don't need the approval of other people to feel good about yourself. If God's reality of his approval is written on the tablet of your heart, you won't need it from people. It may be there, but you won't need it. You understand what I'm saying? You don't resist it, but you don't need it. I must have the approval of certain other people to feel good about myself. That's an acceptance deprivation. And reconciliation is the work of the cross that's missing. I am accepted in the beloved was meant to be part of the finished work. Forgiveness was propitiation. And I've run into this even with praying with pastors and leaders. Without a revelation of supernatural exchange, and it must be a supernatural exchange, not a mental concept of forgiveness or repentance. Repentance and forgiveness must be a supernatural exchange. It must be a supernatural transaction that takes place in the heart or its theory. I found out that I must punish failure. People who fail do not deserve love. They deserve to be punished, and that includes myself. If propitiation or the forgiveness message has not thoroughly impacted, if you've not fallen in love with the spiritual experience of repentance, you will punish yourself. I know there's people that'll do that. Even if they don't get caught, they'll punish themselves. Do you believe that? And most of the Christians we minister to, even in leadership, they're busy beating themselves up more than someone else would beat them up. We have found the enemy. It is you. And you are horrible toward yourself. Even those that walk in a revelation that it's ungodly to judge other people, they still think they've got a right to pick on themselves and talk bad about themselves. No, no. You're something that God made and he loved. You are in sin when you talk bad about yourself. And until you get a grip of that, you will live a minimal Christian experience. Because that forgiveness is for everyone, including you. Those who fail deserve to be punished, and that includes myself. If that's in there, you have yet to walk in the revelation of the forgiveness message of Jesus. Forgiveness is a person. It's not just a pattern, or it's not just a principle. Forgiveness is the person, and he lives within. And he made that provision because he knows. I must punish failure, even if it's me. All right? That's propitiation. Regeneration. Regeneration is, I am what I am by the grace of God. And if there was another thing that we've ministered to people for years and years and years, is shame. They are ashamed of themselves. Look, God's going to move with a holiness anointing. Be ashamed of your sin, okay? Momentarily. Repent. Get clean. But to be ashamed of yourself is ungodly. To be ashamed of who God made, when Jesus hung naked on a cross, took your shame, and said, I'm not ashamed to call them brethren. To literally slap Jesus in the face by saying, that doesn't mean nothing because I am ashamed of me. Stop it. Receive forgiveness for judging your overall personhood as shame when Jesus paid such a high price for that. I am what I am by the grace of God. When I got healed of shame, the first thing that I said was, I am what I am by the grace of God, and I like me. And that sounds almost arrogant, doesn't it? And for some people, they can't even say, I like me, without feeling all twingy inside. If you feel all twingy inside saying, I like me, there's an identity problem in Christ that has not yet emerged properly. But I got so excited when I saw that come to pass. It was like the work of the cross. No other foundation other than Jesus. And on the top, the capstone. The capstone was brought in Zechariah with shouts of grace, grace to it, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Now I want to show you what we've got for the future. This already worked in my life. This already worked in congregations. This already working in this church with the leadership. Okay, this is what we call the vision of the house. You can say it real easy, but it'll take a little bit of time, won't it? Do you want reality or not? That's the difference. This vision of the house is so generic that I believe that if you caught this in your heart and you went out and planted your own church, that if you kind of stuck generically to the model, just generically to the model, it's all the cross, you would prosper because you'd be in the place where you could obey. But don't lay on something, don't lay on somebody else something that you won't live yourself. Right? It had to happen in this temple before God gave me and allowed me to do it in someone else's life. And I had to learn these things. And if I got off track, and I did get off track, when I got off track, I would go back to this and get back on track. Because it was very easy to see where I was missing it. Can you tell where you're missing it on this? The work of the cross maybe needs to be a little bit deeper. So that what's coming out of you is the love, acceptance, forgiveness. And I'll tell you what, the love of God's going to be coming in pre-awakening in the body of Christ. That love's going to come, and it's going to come as holy love. And people are going to get a grip that God is love, but love is not God. Not at the expense of righteousness, it's not. If love, because right now, everybody just puts love, it's God, if it's love. Not if it's at the expense of righteousness. Jesus' love overturned the money changers' tables. Jesus' love called them a brood of vipers. There's times when you look to protect and the safety of other people, and you have to be pretty forthright speaking the truth in love. Here's the last four elements, and we're going to close. And you're going to be able to get ministry today. All right? Here's the last four elements. And this is, you can pray this for me. Because this is where, in 38 years of ministry, this separates out the passionate people and the kind of interested people. One person with passion is worth 99 that are kind of interested. That's why I like, we're teaching at Morningstar University's first and second year, because they wouldn't even be there if they didn't have a level of passion above norm. You don't even go to Bible school. Why would you? You know, if you're just, I just want to go to church on Sunday and hope I get better because the devil beat me up all week. All right? That kind of, they don't go to Bible school anyway. But that passion, here's the four elements of organic growth. That's a good title too, organic growth. It means like first the blade, then the ear, then the full corn. God does things in the kingdom of God or in an organic way. It's natural. It's not, it's supernaturally natural. All right. And here's the way when I pastored my first church, this was the outline that God gave me to develop people, making sure that I had something worth giving. The first one was individual identity. They've got to know who they are in God. They've got to have their own relationship. They can't have somebody else's relationship. They can't have mom and dad's relationship. They must have their own relationship in God. Individual identity. Secondarily, this is where we lose them later. No, they like this part. Individual gifting. I have 4 worship teams, 40 children flaggers, probably 30 or 40 signers. Everybody in the building was doing something, of which God told me I don't need to do that now. Equipped everybody in the building, but all of the equipping was for in the building. 4 dance teams, signers, flags. It looked like an unsaved man came in once and he said, "Who's in charge here? And how does this work without orchestration?" He couldn't even figure out how it worked because everybody had a part. And God says that was an object lesson for that time and that season. Now it's kind of popular. At that time, I got flack for it. I got flack for everything, but all my friends believed something that some people were against, whether it was dancing, flags, church, prophecy, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But anyway, those are the best years of my life because it trained you to know what you believe, all right, and why you believe it. But individual identity and individual gifting, that it was not hard to develop gifting. It was not hard to tell them how much God loved them and how to cultivate their identity. This third level is still my passion, and it's very difficult. The third level is corporate identity. Believers are so terrified that if they opened up to a corporate identity, that somehow their identity will be swallowed up. Like I'm a potato, and if I open up to corporate identity, I'll be mashed potatoes and I won't be able to find me. I'll get lost in the crowd. Success can be individual and selfish. Destiny will include success, but always includes people. There's a destiny for believers. That's why God says army, bride, family. He's not trying to be clever. He's trying to say corporate is a sign of growing up. And people resist it. That third level, I've spent my entire ministry believing God would gather that. And he's doing it. But he's doing it in such a way that I'm still amazed at the resistance to it. We're so afraid that we're going to lose our rugged individualism. When in reality, that's a spiritual teenager. Corporate identity is everything that God put in Jennifer's heart and my heart. And when he brought us together, it was like, this is what we're about. One new man, a corporate entity that will fulfill, be a habitation of God in the Spirit, that would be God welcoming, so that God says, I have a people that were not a people, but they become a people. And these people are going to be a chair for me to rest upon. And I will dwell there, not visit, I will dwell. But it's going to require knittings of the Holy Spirit. It's going to require loving our differences. It's going to require character development. And all of that stuff scares people away, really, because they go, you don't know what my life's like. I just got to make it from day to day. I just got to do this. I just got to put bread on the table. I just got to go to that stinky old job. I just got. So this is not that appealing. But I'll tell you what, you haven't lived until you died to your own agendas and your own fabrications of what would make you happy and just say, I want to please God and make him happy. It's about time we started exalting God instead of our own ideas. And the other area that's difficult is in this corporate identity. Everything God ever did for me came out of my corporate attitude toward being faithful in somebody else's ministry and not being afraid that some man was going to stand in my way for my ministry or something was going to be in the way. That's a common lie. And if I don't do it myself, Ishmael, if I don't do it myself, it won't happen. That's the other common one. That's rugged individualism. It sounds good, but it doesn't work. The last element, and this is what I live for, this is what I breathe for, is that corporate identity, if a person can humble themselves enough to be part of something bigger than themselves, the corporate gifting that comes, something in them will emerge that will never happen by themselves. It's even on a small scale like my previous church. You can't have a dance team without a team. You can't have a worship team without a team. You can't have a corporate anointing by yourself. And God wants an army, a family, right? But you can't do that by yourself. You're not that spiritual. So at some point, we've got to say, I speak to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven and you still live in the gimmies. I speak to you, young men and young women, because you think you've arrived, because the word of God abides in you strong and you've overcome the wicked one. And you can get puffed up like that. People come to me for help because I'm anointed. I'm God's man. That's all good stuff. But it's not until you have the mother-father heart that wants to see the children replicated and doing greater and better things than you. Until you have that heart, you don't have the father's heart. You've got a young man's heart. And I see television evangelists and godly men, but they're still young men. I can tell by their delivery. They're still young men. They don't want to reproduce according to kind. They want to do what they've been called to do, and that's a good thing. But it shouldn't stop there. You should be looking to who can I pour into?
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.